Greetings in the blessed name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Hi, this is Pastor Bobby Paul. I'd like to welcome you today to the internet broadcast of Albany Family Worship Center. Albany Family Worship Center is located at 3024 Kensington Court in Albany, Georgia. Our service times are Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. for midweek Bible study and Sunday mornings at 10:30 a.m. for morning worship. I hope this message encourages you today and draws you ever closer to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Have a blessed day, and always remember this: Jesus loves you.
This message started Thursday morning, and it started with a simple observation. I get up a couple hours before Lisa and John in the morning and read my devotionals, read my scripture, and say my prayers. And as I got up and got ready to, I finished all that, and I went in John's room to wake him up to get him ready for school. And the first thing he done after he got up, after he told me good morning and told me he loved me, he reached up on the head of his bed and he grabbed his Bible and he cut his light off and come into the living room. And as he reached up and grabbed that Bible, the Lord spoke to me, and he says, "You're raising this child right." He said, "You're putting the right stuff in him, and the right stuff's going to come out." And after he spoke that to me, it just kind of knocked my socks off. And God continued to further speak to me through the day about that, and he said this. He said, "You get out what you put in." And that's the title of the message this morning. You're going to get out what you put in. Do you hear what I'm saying this morning? The old saying is, what goes in must come out. And this is true. This is very true. If I take this water and I pour it into this glass, what am I going to get out of it? Hello. Say it again, Ernie. Water. Now, I might want tea or Coke, but I'm going to get water out of it. You're not going to get out of something what you don't put in it. Now, if I want to get tea out of this glass, out of this water I've poured in this glass, I've got to add something to it. Amen? I got to add some tea to it. And I've got to stir it up. And I got some tea. But I'm not going to get out of it what I don't put in it. Hello? If you pour water in a glass, you're going to get water out of it. If you want tea, you gotta put tea in it. The only way you're going to do that is by adding something to it. To that water, if I was going to make traditional tea, I'd add a little sugar, I'd add a tea bag, I'd add a little ice, and I'd get iced tea. And I love my iced tea now. Takes a little longer if you're thirsty, but if you wanted iced tea to quench your thirst, guess what? It's worth it. It just takes a little extra effort and work, and voila, you know what you got? Iced tea. The same is true with us. Everybody listen to the preacher, say amen. See, we're products of our environment. What you're willing to put into your life, what you're willing to put into your life is what comes out of your life. If you're willing to put in godliness, then guess what? Godliness comes out. But if you put in worldliness, all that comes out of your life is worldliness. That is sin. And I know nobody don't like to hear that word. But it's true. It takes a little effort. You got to have a willingness to surrender to Jesus. You got to have a willingness to surrender to His will. And you got to have a willingness to surrender to His word. See, you can live a godly life and still be in this world, but you cannot live a godly life, a worldly life, and expect to be godly. It don't work that way. What goes in comes out. James 3:10 says this, "Out of the same mouth proceedeth blessings and cursings, my brethren. These things ought not to be. Doth a fountain send forth at the same place sweet water and bitter? Can a fig tree, my brethren, bear olive berries, either a vine figs? So can no fountain both yield salt water and fresh. In other words, you can't have something contrary going on in your life. If you want to live a godly life, if you want to have a close, personal, intimate relationship with Jesus, you got to put godly things in your life. If not, you're not going to have that. If you're going to be a happy man or a woman, if you're going to be a blessed man or a woman, you must make up your mind today who you are going to serve, the world or Jesus Christ. See, it's your choice, but you can't do both. You can't play both sides of the street, in other words. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be loyal to one and despise the other. It's your choice today, and you must make it. Hello, you must make it. You cannot play one against the other. You can't straddle the fence. You got to choose. And once you make the choice to follow Jesus and to serve Him, you must be careful. Somebody say careful as to what goes into your life. When you put the right stuff in, the right stuff comes out. My wife cooked me collards for the first time yesterday. She's never cooked collards before. And she started off with a big old pot, put some water in it. She took them collards and dumped over in there. Well, first of all, she dumped some smoked meat in there. And then she dumped them collards in there. Then she put some salt and some pepper and a little onion powder. And then she put the lid on it, turned the heat up. Let it go to cooking. Brought it to a boil. And you know what? It turned out pretty good. But she had to put the right stuff in to get the right stuff out. Amen? And it's the same way with our life. We got to put the right stuff in. Woo! Somebody say amen for me one time. I'm finna get me a Holy Ghost to go running all over this place. Amen. You got to be willing to put the right stuff in to get the right stuff out. So you can't ignore what God has given you. And He's given you. Oh, I got to come down here for just a minute because I want somebody to hear what I'm saying. There's too many people in the church today waiting on what they need to live a godly life. You ain't got to wait no longer. It's already here. I know I'm not using good English this morning, but that's okay. You've already got everything you need to live a godly life, to live a holy life. That's another word folks don't like to hear today. You know, God says this. He says, be holy, for I am holy. Amen? And you know what He does? He's not telling you to live perfectly, because I got news for you. There ain't a one of us in here to live perfectly. Amen? But to live holy, to live a godly life means to live a life that is separated unto God, that's surrendered to Him, that's given over to Him. And you know what? He does the rest. He takes up our slack, amen, when we allow Him. But there's so many people today in the church struggling with godly and holy living, and the reason is they ain't put the right stuff in. They're not putting the right stuff in there. They think they can just live any old way and everything will be all right, but it's not. And let me tell you what, those people on the outside, they look like they're happy, but on the inside, they're miserable. And don't raise your hand, but we got any miserable folks in here this morning. Because, see, there's a battle going on down inside of you between the spirit and the flesh. And the one that's going to grow in your life is the one that you feed the most. You feed the spirit, you feed the spiritual man, you feed the godly man. You know what? That spiritual man, that godly man is going to grow. He's going to grow. He's going to flourish. He's going to live a blessed life. He's going to live a happy life. I'm going to read the scripture in a minute. I feel like preaching just a minute first. Can I do that? Y'all allow me to do that right quick, amen? But if you feed the fleshly man, the worldly man, you know what you're going to get out of your life? You're just going to get worldly things, and you're going to be miserable. There's going to be a hollow spot. And you're going to try everything you can to fill up that hollow spot, but you ain't going to do it. The only thing that's going to fill that hollow spot up is Jesus. Amen. You believe that? Give God a hand clap of praise this morning. Everybody in Psalms chapter 1, I want you to find verse number 1 and say amen. Let's read about 3 verses of Scripture and then we'll get into the message this morning. Amen. It says in Psalms, verse number 1. Psalms 1, verse number 1. Blessed is the man or woman. The key word there is blessed. I like that word in the King James. I like it in the Hebrew and the Greek both, because it means a person that is highly favored. A person that is happy. Hello. An individual that's content. Now that doesn't mean that everything's perfect in their life. Amen. I don't know about y'all, but I feel like I'm blessed. I'm happy. I'm content. But you know what? My life ain't perfect. I have struggles. I have trials. Anybody in here struggling trial free? Say amen. Woo. Martha's getting on him this morning. Amen. Praise God. That's okay. George just excited. He full of the Holy Ghost this morning. Amen. But blessed is the man or woman, the individual, the person. Blessed is the man that walketh not. Somebody say not. That's a little three-letter word, but it's huge. Walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor sitteth in the way of sinners, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. Listen now. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. Verse 3, and he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in the season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall, somebody say shall, prosper. So saith the word of God today. Father, bless the reading of your word. Father God, use this living and powerful word to touch our lives today, to touch our way of thinking, to touch our way of doing things, God. Let it be a motivation for us to live a holy life, to live a godly life dedicated to you. Father God, use this living and powerful word to change us, to mold us, and make us into the men, the women, the young people that you want us to be. Holy Spirit, right now, I ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, that you would take this living and powerful word and impact our lives with it and draw us ever closer to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And Father God, I just stand before you right now and I just ask you to forgive me where I failed you, Lord. Forgive me of my sins. Cleanse me, Father, that I can stand before you right now to receive your mercy and grace. Father, I ask through the power and the presence and the anointing of the Holy Ghost that you would let your words be my words, your thoughts my thoughts, your love in my heart, Jesus, as it flows out and touches everyone in this room. In Jesus' name we pray and say, we love you, Jesus. Amen and amen and amen. Somebody give God a hand clap of praise this morning. This 3 verses of Scripture here is talking about a man or a woman that's trying to live a godly life. And that because that person is trying, because that person has made the Word of God his delight, his motivation for his life, he's happy. He's content. He's like a tree that's planted by the rivers of water. Even though everything around them seems to be falling apart, even though there might be drought and famine and troubles and trials everywhere, they're still bringing forth fruit. They are blessed. Indeed. Amen. Hallelujah. In other words, because they're putting the right stuff in, they're getting the right stuff out. When you put godly ingredients in your life, godly character and godly actions come out. You cannot expect to live godly. You cannot expect to live a blessed life. You cannot expect to live a holy life dedicated to Jesus when all you put into your life is worldly things and associate with worldly people. It don't work that way. Hello. Can somebody hear what I'm saying today? And I want to give you some ingredients that's already in your spiritual closet that God has already given you that will help you live a godly life, and you'll see a life that flourishes. Amen? Can somebody... Oh, I hope I'm getting through to somebody today. Amen. The first thing you got to do is you got to separate yourself from those who are a bad influence on you. Hello? You got to separate yourself from those people that are a bad influence on you. 2 Corinthians 6:14-17 says this: Be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? And what concord hath Christ with Belial? And what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore? Because of this. Whenever you see the word wherefore or therefore in the scripture, you better really pay attention to what come before. Amen? Wherefore, come out from among them and be ye separate. You know, we have a hard time being separate. Hello? We have a hard time giving up things that we don't need to be messing with. People we don't need to be messing with. Bad influences in our life. But God says, be ye separate. Does that mean we don't share the gospel with them? No, it just don't mean, it just means that we don't hang out and we don't fellowship with them. Because what concord has Jesus with Belial? What concord hath a believer with an unbeliever? What have you got in common now that you've been saved? Hello? Nothing. You're supposed to be spiritual, not worldly. Am I making sense to you? Say amen. And God says, come out from among them. Be ye separate. But we have a hard time of letting go of old friends. Well, I guarantee you one thing, you live in a godly life, you live in a life dedicated for Jesus, you ain't got to worry about letting go of them, because they're going to let go of you. They ain't going to want to have nothing to do with you. I'm going to leave, he'll preach to you. Only thing he ever talks about is that there Jesus. Every time I see him, he's reading the Word of God. Come on now. And you know what? That's what we're supposed to be doing. And they don't get it. You see, the natural man can't understand the things of the Spirit because they are spiritually discerned. To the natural man, they're foolishness. But you know what? For some strange reason, we don't like to be thought as odd. Hello? Well, guess what? You know what the Bible now calls us? We're a royal priesthood, a holy nation. Hey, listen now. You ready for this? Peculiar people. We're different. Amen? At least you should be. If you are different if you've been truly and wonderfully saved by the blood of Jesus shed on Calvary's cross for the remission of your sin. If you've been indwelled by the Spirit of God, your life's been changed. You are different. Amen? Hello? Oh, I could preach on that for a while. Glory to God. But we got to separate ourselves from people who are bad influence on us. We got to let them go. Well, Brother John, I'm going to give up my friends. We've been hanging out since we was 3 years old. Yeah, and you've been in trouble since you was 3 years old, too. Hello, somebody. You've been in and out of trouble. Things have been going on in your life. And am I getting through to somebody? Say amen. He says, come out from among them. Be ye separate, saith the Lord. Not the preacher, but the Lord. And touch not the unclean thing. And he says, I will receive you. You guess what? Sometimes you just got to get a whole new set of friends. You got to hang out with a whole new class. I hate that word class, but a whole new bunch of folks. You got to hang out with people that's been just as blood-bought and born again as you are. Amen? You got to be willing to let go. Or better yet, do this. Let the Lord put the people around you that He knows will be best for you in your life in Christ Jesus. Those people that will build you up and not bring you down. Those people who will help you grow in grace and not be dragged back into the muck and the mire of a sinful lifestyle. Can somebody hear what I'm saying today? Isaiah said in Isaiah 52:11, depart ye, depart ye. Now listen, whenever you see a writer of the scripture repeating itself, you need to pay attention. Do I need to come knock on your forehead this morning? Listen, depart ye, depart ye. Go ye out from thence, touch no unclean thing. Go ye out of the midst of her, be ye clean that bear the vessel of the Lord. And guess what? God will put the people around you that need to be around you. He'll put you in contact with the people that will build you up and not bring you down. Romans 8:28, and we know that all things. When God removes somebody out of your life and is trying to put a godly person in, you better let Him. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, them that are called according to His purpose. Separate yourself from those bad influences. Number two, you need to listen to this one real close now. Get into and study the Word of God and then apply it to your life. You know what I see most people doing? The only time they touch this Word is when they come to church. Hello? They don't never just pick it up and read it to be reading it. But guess what? They'll pick up a Sports Illustrated, especially, guys, if it's the swimsuit edition. Hello? They'll pick up an old trashy novel. Now, look, there's nothing wrong with reading clean books. Amen? I love to read Louis L'Amour. I love them old westerns. I'm a cowboy at heart. Amen? And I love to read Louis L'Amour books. But there's nothing trashy in them. I'm careful. Hello. And you've got to be careful. The best thing to do is you get into the study and the reading of the Word of God. Let me tell you something. I don't go to bed at night without reading this. And I don't get up in the morning without reading this. And anywhere I go during the day, I got a Bible with me. They say, well, you're a preacher. No, I'm a child of God. Reading the Word ain't got nothing to do with being a preacher. Studying the Word of God ain't doing nothing. It doesn't have anything to do with a preacher. Everybody needs to be studying the Word of God. Amen. If you're a child of God, you need to be studying the Word of God so you can understand what God's trying to say to you. You got to know it. And the more you're willing to read, the more He's willing to reveal to you. Look here, if I don't have my Bible physically in my hand, I got two on my phone and three on my tablet. And both of those things go everywhere I go, amen? I can just read Word of God wherever I'm at. I love to read and study. As a matter of fact, not only do I have Bibles on, I got Greek and Hebrew lexicons on there, so I can go to the original languages if I need to. But you got to be willing to get into and study the Word of God. Then apply it. See, it don't do you no good to read it and learn it and understand it and then not apply it. It's like having a brand new can of paint and your wall needs painting, but you won't open that can of paint and apply it to the wall. Hello? Does that make sense to you? Say amen. You got to be willing to apply it. Psalms 119:9 says this, wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed. I hate it when people don't pay attention. If you don't pay attention, you ain't going to get nothing done. If you don't heed it, it ain't going to happen. Let me tell you something. When Daddy was telling us to do something when we were kids, if we didn't pay attention, if we didn't heed his word, you know what? We got chastised. He says, heed thereto according to thy word. Not only read it, but apply it. It says in 2 Timothy 2:15, it says, study Read it. Look into it. And apply it. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. That word rightly dividing gives us the idea of a butcher that's laid a carcass on his butcher block and he splits it right down the black backbone to have two even sides. It's rightly divided. It's equaled out. Everything's where it's supposed to be. Hello. And that's what we're supposed to do with the Word of God. When we study the Word of God, the Holy Spirit gives us interpretation. The Holy Spirit reveals it to us, amen. And we can rightly divide the Word of truth. We begin to understand it and we say, wow, I never seen that before. I understand that now. Because all because you was willing to pick up, read, and study, and apply the Word of God to your life. Instead of leave it sitting on the living room coffee table gathering dust. I bet some of you, when you pick your Bible up and get ready to come to church, you got to blow the dust off of it so the preacher won't know you've been ignoring it. Ooh, I ain't looking. I'd have said that and looked up. Somebody said, well, he's picking on me. But guess what? If the shoe fits, wear it. Let me tell you something. You pick up one of my Bibles, you better be careful. That joke is liable to fall apart in your hand. Most of them are hell. I've sewed the covers back on some, used Gorilla tape on others, and double-sided automotive tape on even other ones. Amen. Because I ain't throwing it away. I'm going to keep it. You pick up one of my Bibles, there's writing and stuff all in it. There's gem clips in them. There's post-it notes in them, amen. Because I want to read and understand and apply that word to my life. You got to be willing to study to show yourself approved. Am I getting through to somebody? Say amen. You got to be willing today. The Word of God gives direction to your life. Psalms 19:105. The Word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. You don't know. Calm down. Whew. I won't sleep in a dark house. It's not because I'm scared of the dark. Amen. I quit being scared of boogers when I turned 21 years old. When I get up, walk through the house at night, I don't want to stomp my toe on the leg of the couch. Any of you ever done that before? Come on now. Or better yet, Lisa might have rearranged. Lisa's bad about when I go to bed before she does, and because I get up earlier than she does. And she's bad about moving stuff around. After I went, she'll get to sit there and thinking, well, you know, that'll look nicer over here. And she'll move stuff. Guys, your wives have done that to you before when you wasn't around? And if there's not a light burn, when I get up, I'll walk into stuff. Because if I get up and go get a glass of water, I'll leave my glasses laying on the bedside table. And guess what? I can't see nothing without my glasses on. But if there's a light on, I can see blurry shapes and I'll avoid them. Amen. I don't want to stump my toe when I'm walking through the house. That's the reason there's always a light on somewhere. It's either in the bathroom or in the kitchen. Am I making sense to you, Bubba? Say amen. I want to know where I'm going. I want a light to my path. I want to have clear direction. Somebody, come on now. And that's what the Word of God is. The Word of God is a light unto our path and a lamp unto our feet. It shows us what direction to go in. I mean, there's a lot of times in life I say, well, what do I do now? Any of you have asked that question before? Well, what do I do now? Where do I go now? What needs to happen now? Well, guess what? You get in the Word and He'll show you. He'll give you direction. He'll show you which way to go. You just got to be willing to open it. You got to be willing to pick it up, to read it, to study it, and He'll give you clear direction on the way you need to go. Lovingly and faithfully obeying the Word of God fills your hollow spot with the love and the presence of Jesus Christ. I've had so many people say to me, well, I just want to feel the presence of Jesus. I'm saved, Pastor, but it feels like I'm all alone. Well, are you in the Word? Are you living out the Word? Can somebody, I wish I could shake you. Are you living out the Word in your life? It says, and Jesus says in John 14:15, if you love me, keep my commandments. You say you love me, keep my commandments. John 14:21, he that have my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me, and he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him, listen, and will manifest myself to him. Hello. Walk in the Word of God. He's going to show up and show out in your life. Amen. He's going to make himself known to you. It says in John 14:23, Jesus answered and said unto him, if a man love me, he will keep my words, and my Father will love him, and we will come unto him, and we will make our abode with him. All from keeping the Word of God. The truth of God's word and the truth that is in Jesus, that is Jesus Christ, will set you free from the bondage of sin that is sinful living, ungodly living in your life. You no longer will struggle with temptation because you got the word of God to set you free. Jesus said in 8:32, and you shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Amen. You believe that? Give God a hand clap of praise today. The third ingredient you got to apply to your life is this: prayer. You got to pray and seek the revealed Word of God for your life. See, this is the inspired Word of God. It's living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. But then when you're in prayer and you're willing to listen, God will reveal his perfect will for your life. Amen? But you got to be willing to listen. You got to be willing to get in prayer. You just can't jump up out of the bed, pull your clothes on, jump in the car, and go to work and say, Lord, bless me today, and arrive at work and go get busy. You hadn't listened. Hello? You hadn't took time. You hadn't spent time with Jesus. You hadn't went and got in your prayer closet. And that prayer closet can be in your bathroom, in your kitchen, in your living room, on your back porch, on your front porch, out of your, wherever you can spend some alone time with God. Well, you know, I have to get up a little earlier. Well, guess what? What's 15 minutes going to do to you? For, I don't know about y'all. 15 minutes ain't nothing for me. Amen? I mean, 15 minutes of sleep, what? Come on. I try to get up an hour or two before I'm supposed to be anywhere, and I try to spend at least 45 minutes to an hour every morning with God. I want to hear what Father has to say. Hello? And you know what? 9 times out of 10, he speaks and reveals something. Amen? He's going to show me something. If it ain't nothing but for me personally to encourage me for the day, it might be a message that he wants me to preach like this one. It might be something he wants me to speak into somebody's life, but God will reveal his plan and purpose to you. Amen? If you're willing to sit down and get in prayer and listen, seek his will for your life. The problem is most of us ain't willing. I want to say that again. Most of us ain't willing. You know why? Because we're worried about what we might hear. Hello? We're worried about what we might hear. We worried about what God might say. See, most people don't like criticism, don't like to be told that they're doing the wrong things. Hello? But you know, for every son he loves, he chastens. Thank God my daddy told me where I was going wrong at, because it put me on the right path. Made me the man I am today. Daddy corrected me when I needed correcting. And he often done it in a loving way. Now, if I didn't pay attention, things got drastic. Amen? And it's the same way with God. If you'll just pay attention and do what he says, you don't have nothing to worry about. But if you don't, things might get drastic. Amen? I don't know about y'all. God's got drastic with me before. Come on now. I'm not ashamed to admit it. I'm glad he did, because it got me around to the right way of thinking and the right way of doing. Can somebody hear what I'm saying today? And what we need to do when we get in prayer and we begin to seek God's will, if we'll just pray, if we'll just communicate with God and listen. He will show you what to do. See, you have the Word to tell you the inspired will of God for your life. Now it's time to communicate with God in prayer to hear the revealed will of God for your life. But you got to remember, the revealed will, that is the Rhema Word of God in your life, will never contradict this inspired Word of God, this inspired will of God for your life. I've had so many people say, well, God spoke to me and told me to do so and such, and what they said is completely contrary to the Word. That ain't God. Hello? God will never contradict His Word. How many of you know that? They say amen. You just got to listen. You got to be able to discern. Psalm 16:11 says, thou wilt show me the path of life. God will show you what direction to go in. Thou wilt show me the path of life. In thy presence, in the presence of Jesus, in the presence of God, in thy presence is fullness of joy. You want to be happy, get in the presence of God. Get in the presence of God. At thy right hand there are pleasures forevermore. Be willing, and God will show up and show out in your life. Prayer should be a way of life for the child of God. Jesus said that men ought always do pray and not faint. Don't give up. Careful. Some of you are too quick to throw your hands up and holler calf rope. Some of you are quick to throw your hands up and say, well, I give up. I've been praying about this for 2 weeks. I've been praying about this for 2 months. I've been praying about this for 2 years, and ain't nothing happened yet. Well, keep praying. It ain't time. Am I talking to somebody, amen, that's been praying about something forever and ever and ever? Just hold on. God's coming, amen. You got to be willing. You gotta not faint. Paul said this, pray continuously. Pray without ceasing. Jesus said again in Luke 21:36, watch ye therefore and pray always, that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man. Don't give up. Ooh, how many times have I wanted to throw my hands up and quit? How many times have I wanted to throw my hands up and just walk the other way? But God always says, come on back. And I pray it again, amen. And you know what? It was worth it. Amen? Because God showed up and showed out. When you're willing to seek God out, when you're willing to run to Him in time of need, you will have what you need when you need it. You will be made whole when you come to Jesus. You know what the problem is? There's too many of us waiting for Jesus to come to us. Now look, when Jesus comes to you, you still get your miracle. But when you run to Jesus, you see an overabundance of blessing in your life. When you come to Him. It says in Mark 7:7, Jesus is asking, it will be given to you. Seek and ye shall find, knock and it shall be opened unto you. What did the woman with the issue of blood do? She sought out Jesus. She sought Him out in such a way that she had to crawl through the crowd. She had to push her way through the crowd just to touch the hem of His garment, because she said in her heart, if I can just touch the hem of His garment, I shall be healed. Amen. But Jesus went a step further. Not only was she healed, but because she sought Him out, because she put the effort in, He said, daughter, because of your faith, you have been made whole. Amen. Seek Him out. Well, if Jesus wants to heal me, He'll heal me. Well, guess what? He wants to heal you. When you have faith as big as a grain of a mustard seed, God works miracles in your life. He's either, listen, he's either going to heal that situation you in, or he's going to ride you above it. But when you seek him out, he makes you whole, complete in every way. If you believe that, give God a hand clap of praise today. The fourth ingredient you've got to have is this, the Holy Ghost. You got to be filled with the Holy Ghost. You got to be filled with the Holy Spirit, and you got to give him control. Now, I know today it's not popular to be filled with the Spirit, be baptized in the Holy Ghost, be overwhelmed by the Spirit. People say, well, you're just being emotional. Well, guess what? Those emotions come from God. Amen? I want to be filled with the Spirit. I want the things of God to be revealed to me. See, you can't know the things of God unless the Spirit give them to you. Hello? You can't leave the Holy Ghost out of the equation. He's the third person of the Trinity. It's God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. Somebody say Holy Ghost. Three in one. If you got God the Father, you need God the Son. You got God the Son, you need God the Holy Spirit. Got to have all three. It's a complete set. You can't leave none of it out. You got to be filled with the Spirit. Paul says this in Ephesians 5:18, and be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. That means that word fill means to be so full, it's running out. Amen? It's running over. Praise God. That when you get around people, it's just something about you. Oh, what? Whoa! You feel with the Spirit, it's running out. It's oozing out your pores. Amen? You may not speak in tongues, but guess what? He's got a gift for you. Amen? You may not interpret, but he's got a gift for you, amen? And you just got to be willing to receive it. Be filled with the Spirit. Jesus said in John 14:16, let me tell you what Paul said first. Paul said in Galatians 5:16, this I say then, walk in the Spirit, be led by the Spirit, live in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Hello? Jesus said this in John 14:16, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. I don't know about y'all, but I need comforting. And guess what? You can't have a comforter unless you got a discomfort. Hello? And there ain't a one of us in here today, I don't care what people say. I've had people come, well, preacher, something must be wrong in your life. I don't need comforting. I don't need a feeling today. I don't need none of that. That person was lying to me. Because I don't know a person that doesn't need comfort right now. Amen? About something. Hello? I don't care how big or how small. I just want him to come hold my hand. John Daniel's getting to be a big boy. And when we get out of the car in a parking lot, or get ready to cross the street if we're walking somewhere, he'll reach up and grab my hand. Because he finds comfort when daddy holds his hand. And we'll walk across that parking lot together. But the moment we get ready to go in that store, boy, he gets that hand out of the way. See, he done got across the parking lot. He done got across the street. But when we come back out and get ready to go, guess what he does? Grabs that hand again. I like to grab Jesus' hand, amen. I want to feel his power and his presence. I don't never want to be without it. I'll never forget one Sunday morning I was preaching in another church on an early morning service, and the Lord spoke to me as I got up to bring the word today. He said, this is what it feels like when I take my comfort, when I take my Spirit away from you. I went through that message in less than 5 minutes, amen. And it was just as dry and dusty and dull as it could be, praise God. And I told God after, I said, Lord, I don't never want to be without your Spirit again, amen. I don't never want to be without your filling, amen. Because, see, these folks didn't believe in the filling of the Holy Ghost, amen. They didn't believe that, that power, the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit. Let me tell you something. I've experienced it, and I don't want to do without it. Amen? I want him there 24/7. I want to feel his comfort in my life and everything I do. You believe that? Give God a hand clap of praise this morning. Jesus went on to say in John 14:26, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost. Somebody say Holy Ghost. Which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name. He comes in the name of Jesus. He is Jesus. Amen. He's the Spirit of the living God. He shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remember whatsoever I have said unto you. Let me tell you something, church. I want you to hear these words. Only the Holy Spirit can reveal the deep things of God to you. Only the Holy Spirit can discern to you the things of God. It says in 1 Corinthians 2:9-10, but it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him. But God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit, by his Holy Ghost, by his Holy Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things of God. Don't shut him out. Don't hinder him. Let him have his will and his way with you. He is the revealer of the things of God to us. He is the seal of our redemption. And he's the giver of spiritual gifts. Yes, and everybody in here's got a spiritual gift. It might be vacuuming the church. It might be working in the yard. It might be administration. It might be clerical work. It might be standing up and giving a prophetic utterance. It might be speaking in tongues. It might be the interpretations of tongues. It may be the laying on of hands. It might just be praying for somebody. But every one of us in here have a spiritual gift given to us by the Holy Ghost. Don't shut him out. Paul writes in 1 Thessalonians 5:19, quench not the Spirit. Quench not the Spirit. Ephesians 4:30 says, and grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby we are sealed unto the day of redemption. The Spirit is given to us for a reason. We need him. We can't know the things of God without the Spirit of God giving them to us. Amen. It says in 1 Corinthians 12:7, but the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit with all. In other words, when he gives you a spiritual gift, it's not for you, it's not to edify you, it's to help edify and build the church. See, he's got a plan and a purpose for you. You just got to surrender and let him have his will and his way with you. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit. You ever just seen somebody that had faith enough they could believe God for anything and boom, it's manifest? Because they didn't doubt. You can have that. Only thing you got to do is believe him completely. To one is given by the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another diverse kinds of tongue, to another interpretation to come. But all these, somebody say all of them. But all these worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit, the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of God, dividing to every man severely as he will. Don't shut him out. You want to learn to live godly? Put the right ingredients in your life. You want to live a holy life? Put the right ingredients in. Separate yourself from those that are a bad influence on you. Get into the Word, study the Word, and then apply it to your life. Pray and seek the revealed will of God for your life. Be willing to get in the prayer closet, hello, hard head, and listen. Make your petitions known, but then just put your hands in your lap and say, God, here I am. And he'll speak. He'll tell you what you need to know. He'll show you which way to go. Be willing to pray and seek the real will of God of God. And finally, be filled with the Holy Ghost. Give him control. Get happy. He's got everything you need this morning. Stop your kicking and your squalling and your struggling. Just cause it pinches a little bit, so what? It's all going to work out in the end. The problem is that God, it's not that God doesn't have what you need, it's that you're just not willing to receive it. You're so used to doing things your way. Is anybody in here like that besides me? Come on. Come on, somebody talk to the preacher. You just, those of you that don't want to raise your hand, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. Let me tell you something. I've had to learn it can't be my way. It's got to be his way. He's got everything you need. Let him pour in those godly ingredients. And I guarantee you one thing, godly stuff will start coming out. It's like shaking up a coat. You pop the top, it's going to spew. Amen. It'll go everywhere. It'll get on you. It'll get on everybody around you. Amen. Come on, somebody. How far are you willing to go? Are you tired of boo-hoo and complaining and moaning? Well, God just don't love you. Ooh. Yeah, he does. And he's got everything you need. To pick up those godly ingredients from a pot and put them in your life. And I guarantee you, listen to me, if you'll do this, I guarantee you, you'll feel good. And when you believe that, give God a hand clap of praise today. All heads are bowed. All eyes are closed. There's nobody looking around. This is your time with God. Will you apply these godly ingredients in your life? Will you just separate yourself from those that are a bad influence on you? Will you just begin to read and study the Word of God? Will you just stop and pray and see God's revealed will for your life? Will you be filled with the Holy Ghost? And I guarantee you, if you do, you'll finally realize what God's will is all about. These altars are open, whatever you'll need today. I'm going to invite you right now to stand and to come and let us pray together. Won't you come? Won't you come? Won't you come?
Hi, this is Pastor Bobby Paul again. I hope you enjoyed today's message. It has encouraged and drawn you ever closer to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And there may be some of you out there today that's made a decision of faith. That is the decision to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And it's so simple to do today. The Bible teaches us that if we'll just confess with our mouth and believe in our heart the Lord Jesus Christ, you shall be saved. For whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And you can call upon him right now by saying this simple prayer of faith. Say, Dear Lord Jesus, forgive me, a sinner. Right now, Lord, I turn from sin and self, and I turn to you, Jesus, and I ask you to come into my heart and be my Lord and Savior. Lord Jesus, I give you all authority, control, and care of my life. Be my Lord and Savior forevermore. I love you, Jesus. Amen. If you just said that prayer, you just become a blood-bought, born-again child of God. And we would love to hear your decision here at Albany Family Worship Center. And here's how you can contact us. You can write us at Albany Family Worship Center, 3024 Kensington Court, Albany, Georgia, 31721. You can send us an email, and our email address is myafwc@gmail.com. That's myafwc@gmail.com. Or you can call us at 229-434-0342. We're looking forward to hearing from you today, and we would love for you to come and visit. We'd love to meet you and the family. Have a blessed day, and always remember this, Jesus loves you.